My work has been principally dealing with the Texas Rangers prior to the age when they were law enforcement. Back in the days when Texas Ranger, well, as one federal officer on the Texas frontier prior to the Civil War put it, he said, as every Massachusetts man was a Minuteman, every Texan is a Ranger. And what he was talking about were volunteers or state troops known variously in the early decades as minute companies, irregulars, and believe me, oftentimes they were very irregular in terms of dress and method and mode. But the name that stuck was the name Rangers. So some people, if they come thinking they're going to hear about modern 20th century law enforcement, that's not where I'm at in my work. My first volume took the story of the Lower Rio Grande. And by the way, you don't say Rio Grande River, do you? Because in Spanish you're saying Great River, River, if you do that. The Lower Rio Grande. And I took that up to the beginning of the American Civil War. And at the center of that story was a man who emerged to me as being heroic and complex and very difficult to understand, John S. Ford, Old Rip, as the Texans came to call him. But in the next volume, the central figure, or at least one of the central figures along the U.S.-Mexican border, and when I say Lower Rio Grande, I'm talking about the region below the Devil's River in Valverde County, all the way down to the Laguna Madre and off the coast of South Texas. And as you know, it was a very violent time and place, and I'm trying to present a balanced view of the events, not the view of only one race or one nation or one side, but everybody's history, which is important or significant. And I thought what I'd do tonight is offer a few vignettes. Vignettes is a fancy French word for just a few shorts to give you an idea of what is in the book. But the title of the upcoming book, or at least the working title, the University of Oklahoma worked with me on the other book, and they're waiting on this one, so I'm hoping they'll publish this one too. The sequel to my book, Texas Devils, is tentatively titled A Crooked River. Rustlers, Rangers, and Regulars along the Lower Rio Grande, 1863 to 1877. In the introduction, I sort of set the stage for this by talking about the land, and I'm not going to read all of the introduction to you, but I began in this way to set the tone for the study. Like a dagger, the southern tip of Texas points to Mexico. Flat, dry, mostly treeless, the sandy plain cuts 150 miles and more below the Nueces River, slicing across a semi-arid prairie choked and gnarled with mesquite, knotted shrubs, and clumps of creosote and chaparral. Thickets of thorny brush are so entangled and intertwined that a man on horseback, or even an entire herd of cattle, could disappear and become lost for days at a time. Little separates heaven and earth there but barbed wire fences and stunted vegetation. With the exception of an occasional windmill, hardly an object rises higher than the head of a horse. On a typical day, the sun blazes overhead, knifing through scattered clouds that drift in from the Gulf of Mexico like white puffs of smoke. Little obscures the blue sky there, the sky that stretches from one horizon to the other, or at night the pale glow of a moon and the infinity of stars that flicker above. It is as if the drought-scarred land of the Lower Rio Grande Valley is so remote, so far from the heavens, so far from everything, except Mexico. So I set the stage there and then talk about, really, if you're going to pursue the story of the Texas Rangers from their very beginnings during the time of colonization and the Republic of Texas all the way up through the modern era, really the point of departure, the beginning point, is with Walter Prescott Webb. I noticed on that last film, the really outstanding film that was done on Sam Bass, you know, here of local interest, less than a year before he was shot mortally wounded down in Round Rock, robbing a bank down there. I noticed there was a brief quote from Walter Prescott Webb. I don't know how many of you have heard of him. He's probably the most, I think, the most eminent scholar that Texas ever produced. Not necessarily because of his book on the Texas Rangers, but his book, The Great Plains, which I'm not here to talk about tonight. But I set the stage by talking about Webb and his thesis, and I just recently wrote a biographical essay on Walter Prescott Webb for a book for the University of Texas titled Writing the Story of Texas. And it's a biographical essay. My wife, Carol, who's with me tonight, she said that after she read it, she said, you not only related to Webb, I think you started to put yourself into his story, because so much of Webb's story, I could see myself and became very empathetic with him because of his interest. He bore the brand of being a genuine Texan scholar and uniquely and distinctively Texan in every way. Walter Prescott Webb, in 1935, his book, The Texas Rangers, A Century of Frontier Defense, was published. And it was published, it's been published so many times, there's a copy of the 1963 or 64 edition right out here in the hallway. And in the book, Webb is really trying to justify the very existence of the Texas Rangers as an institution, a modern law enforcement institution, because some members of the Texas State Legislature were proposing to ban the Texas Rangers. Now, what happened after 2 or 3 years was that they ended up as truly an elite law enforcement corps within the Department of Public Safety under Homer Garrison, who supervised the Rangers for the better part of the next 3 decades. But Webb, you have to understand, in writing the history, he admits in his own memoir, which has never been published, and I use this in the essay I wrote on old Professor Webb, Webb confessed that his vantage point had changed over the years from 1935, when that study was published, up until the first few weeks of 1963. And I found 2 letters that he exchanged with a gentleman in South Texas by the name of Enrique Mendiola. I don't know who Mendiola was, and it doesn't really matter, but he was a Texan of Mexican heritage. And Webb wrote back to Mendiola, who wrote him a rather polite but scorching letter saying that you really didn't tell the side of Tejanos in your book, The Texas Rangers. And nearly 3 decades later, Webb wrote back to him, I understand that you or any citizen of Mexican descent would be impatient with my account. Then Webb shared that along the border during the 19th century, cattle theft had always been the stock in trade of not just Mexican but Anglo alike. And Webb admitted this in the letter, and it struck me, and I'm using this in the introduction to my book. If the Kings and Kennedys, referring to Richard King and Mifflin Kennedy, and the Armstrongs and Shanghai Pierce and others, if they did not put their brands on other people's stock, well, they were the only cow people of that age who failed to do so. These Texans even stole cattle from one another, Webb confessed. The unfortunate fact is that the Mexicans were not as good at keeping records as the people on this side of the border. And Webb closed his letter out. He wrote him another letter at a future date, and within a matter of weeks, Walter Prescott Webb, who planned on another edition of the Texas Rangers, and with some revisions, Professor Webb died in an automobile accident south of Austin, near present-day Buda, Texas. Well, the story of the Texas Rangers, like any story, it has more than one side. The story of the Lower Rio Grande and U.S.-Mexican relations, obviously, it has more than one side. Professor Webb was coming to realize that, I think, even more so. But he also admitted in his letters, never published and not even to this date, that he struggled to find what he called a common thread through the history of the Texas Rangers. And he concluded in his research that that one thread was what he called the great leaders, the great captains. I think where he fell a little short, and his book is a monument to Texas history, it's a classic, it's nothing less than that. But I think where Webb fell just a little bit short was he saw the institution of the Rangers over the generations from the top down. and not necessarily from the bottom up, not from those rank and file who served in these companies and who were in the service of Texas during one conflict or another. And so what I've tried to do in my own work is look at sources that Webb either didn't have available to him way back in the 1930s, or that he neglected, ignored, or he just failed to find. So I conclude my introduction with a simple statement here that this is the story that Walter Prescott Webb never told. Okay. Just a few shorts here. The key here, or the central figure in my study, is this next volume, is Leander Harvey McNelly. I don't know how many of you have heard of McNelly. He becomes a legend, an icon in Texas history, and a very complex man in his own right. But that makes him all the more interesting to me. So let me just open up at first and just introduce you to Captain McNelly, the captain. In several respects, I wrote, he was a most unlikely hero. A handsome, clean-cut man, barely 30, though you see by the time that this portrait was made, probably in 1873, that he had quite a goatee and mustache, but neatly trimmed most of the time. He was the son of a sheep herder, and killing was against his gentle nature. There seemed to be a certain softness to him, though he never allowed himself to reveal that to the men who served in his company. After the Civil War, the quiet and unassuming L.H. McNelly, that's how he signed his name, he married a pretty young farm girl named Carrie Cheek, and they settled down on a place west of Brenham in Washington County, near the hamlet of Burton. And there he took up the plow and raised 100 acres of cotton and two children, a boy and a girl. He was a young man who George Durham, who served under him, Durham described him as a little runt of a feller. You know, this is not what, when we think of Texas Rangers and iconic figures in the history of the Rangers, we think of tall Texans, you know, John Wayne types. He was described as a little runt of a feller who spoke in a thin, piping voice that at times sounded like a coughing whisper. At first glance, he seemed gaunt, surely timid, shy. His dark, gray-streaked mustache and goatee made him look a little older than he really was, and only partially concealed a boyish face and what one observer referred to as kind eyes. Most would have taken him for a circuit-riding preacher, not a lawman. After all, along with a Colt revolver, he carried a Bible in his saddlebags, and he read it most every day. But his voice and appearance were deceiving. He would not hesitate to meet violence with violence and cruelty with even more cruelty if necessary. Simply put, he lived by the Old Testament injunction, one wrote, an eye for an eye. And I added to that, and if necessary, he was prepared to die by that injunction. Many perpetuated the myth that McNelly had stared down death so many times that he was afraid of dying. It was said that he simply wanted someday to die well in a worthy cause. What few people knew about the storied Confederate guerrilla fighter, and he's sort of into the Louisiana campaigns of 1863-64, what the swamp fox Francis Marion was in South Carolina in the American Revolution. He became a rather iconic figure on the Louisiana-Texas border. This young man from Virginia. What few people knew about him, and he concealed it as best he could, is he was already dying of tuberculosis, what they call consumption in those days. A dreaded disease for which there was no treatment and surely no cure. He concealed it well, just like he hid the fact that beneath the harsh exterior and brusque manner of a lawman was a loving father and husband. That's a portrait of him I found of all places down at San Jacinto at the Hertzberg Museum a few years ago when I found that it had never yet been published. It was just published last year in a book on one of McNelly's men, Pidge Robinson. All said, I wrote here, McNelly was a complicated man, a hard man to know, even harder to understand, especially if you were an outlaw. The way he moved, the way he spoke, his swagger, unlike so many who simply exuded confidence, there was something else about L.H. McNelly. Something about his manner that distinguished him from others. Something intuitive, difficult to define. Those who rode alongside him in the ranging service in South Texas swore that instinctively he seemed to know things that no one else around him knew. That he even appeared to be able to smell danger, as one of his men said. Even before he led his company from Washington County, a company of volunteers that, if you look at the muster rolls, it fluctuated from 31 or 32 up to about 40, you know, as they came and they went, and maybe a couple sometimes deserted or went back home with his permission. But a company of 30 to 40 or so state troops, they were referred to as the Special Force under Captain McNelly. Those who followed him southward to the Lower Rio Grande, they were already saying that he was the last of his kind and folks would not see his like again. A man to be respected, no one doubted that. Even more, he was the kind to be feared. And that, the bandits of South Texas were soon to learn. April 18th, 1875, and I'm just going to move in and out of some of this, and I'll try to keep from lurching around too much for you. April 18th, 1875, the Adjutant General of the State of Texas, William Steele, now he serves the governor as the chief military officer in Texas for decades, the Adjutant General. William Steele received a telegram from Sheriff John McClure of Nueces County. Is McNelly coming? We're in trouble here. Five ranches have been burned by disguised men near La Para last week. Answer. 4 days later, McClure got his answer. For in the early gray of the morning, Captain McNelly and his men crossed the Nueces, ready to administer gunpowder justice. Now, I go into this chapter, McNelly's Rangers. I explained that Captain McNelly, when he arrived in South Texas, and he had just participated in the suppression of one of the longest, bloodiest feuds in Texas history. And there were many a feud during the Reconstruction era, most of them related to old, unresolved hatreds from the Civil War. But the so-called Sutton-Taylor feud around Cuero and Gonzales in that area. And McNelly was then ordered by Governor Cope to head southward to the border because there was yet another, even larger task for him. Already word had spread that McNelly's method of bringing back bodies, not prisoners, had preceded him. As Ranger William Callicott wrote to historian Walter Prescott Webb years later, thinking there's Bill Callicott right there. His papers are at the University of Texas, and they're very colorful and an excellent source for anyone delving into this particular Ranger company and this subject. He said McNelly had orders to deal with the bandits the same way that Major Jones, John Jones, had dealt with the Indians on the frontier. If caught on this side of the river with stolen cattle, kill them. Durham likewise recalled that the Rangers' brutally effective means of shooting first and investigating later. Other Ranger captains before McNelly, according to Callicott, had tried to fight according to the books as written in Austin. The military had to fight by the books as written in Washington. But those Nueces outlaws didn't fight by any books, George Durham charged. Neither did Captain McNelly. They made their own rules and the captain made his. They didn't mind killing, and neither did Captain McNelly. They didn't take prisoners. Neither did Captain McNelly. I close the quote there. That's just a brief introduction to Leander Harvey McNelly, whose mother wanted him to grow up to be a circuit riding minister. Well, the next vignette, I'll call it Old Cassoose. Old Cassoose. McNelly's scouting parties returned to camp almost daily with reports of rustlers crossing the river into Mexico with dust clouds of cattle bearing Texas brands. By June the 5th, this is still 1875, by June the 5th, McNelly had bivouacked at Las Rusias in Cameron County, north of or above upriver from Brownsville. 1 week later, acting on information gathered by his spies operating above and below the river, on both sides of the border, in other words, the captain ordered 17 of his Rangers, almost half of his company mustered in, to ride off to La Para below Brownsville. The next day, they picked up the tracks of a small party of raiders herding cattle southward to the banks of the Rio Bravo, another phrase for the Rio Grande, the Rio Bravo, river known by many names. Within 48 hours, the Rangers captured one of the alleged bandits, then a second. Both of the prisoners suffered the misfortune of being turned over to Jesus Sandoval, one of McNally's scouts. By the way, I found out that Sandoval was wanted for murder in Starr County, and he was serving in this Ranger company and was a scout, or a spy, as they would have preferred to call. He would bring information back to his captain. The cattle thieves could not have had a more terrifying enemy. Old Casus, the Rangers called him. He was tall, a brooding figure, with dark, penetrating eyes and shoulder-length auburn hair, with a beard speckled with streaks of gray. According to George Durham, Casus was, quote, what you would call spooky in appearance. He looked like a crazy man, and I think that's what he was, Durham remembered. A man who lived only to kill and to have his revenge against Juan Cortina's rustlers, who raided his rancho 15 miles upriver from Brownsville the previous year. Apparently, during Jesus Sandoval's absence, rustlers had raped his wife and daughter and burned his adobe ranch house to the ground, stolen his livestock, and threatened that they would return to kill him and his family if they cooperated with the gringo officials, with Los Rinches, the Rangers, north of the border. Sandoval's, quote, fierce glittering eyes, as Napoleon Jennings put it, revealed the hate that he harbored and the terrible vengeance that he sought. In other words, he had a score to settle. Just days before joining up with Captain McNally, Sandoval had hanged four alleged horse thieves from the same tree near the Rio Grande, leaving their corpses swinging in the wind as a grisly reminder to all bandits who cross the border into Texas. Now old Casus, as the Rangers called him, and again he's operating for McNally and his company of Rangers, old Casus used the same gruesome method to extract information from the two captives taken at La Para. He would take each to an isolated tree, tie a rope around their necks, toss the rope over a limb, then hoist the man 2 or 3 feet into the air, strangling him for several moments before lowering back to the ground. The ritual was repeated several times until the suspected spy had apparently told all that he knew. As far as we knew, Ranger Callicott speculated, this treatment always brought out the truth. After McNally was satisfied with the confession of the two men, he left the scene, and Casus tied a hangman's noose, looped it over each man's head, and forced them to stand on top of his old paint horse, one and then the other. It's what I called in another chapter Casus's paint horse gallows. Sandoval walked behind the animal, and he would switch it on the hindquarters, causing it to dash away, thus sending the victim into the air, breaking his neck. Captain McNally didn't like this kind of killing, Bill Callicott insisted, but Casus did. As Callicott remembered, we caught several spies on that scout, and Casus dealt with all of them alike, showing no impartiality. He always made them a present of 6 feet of rope. It's pretty chilling. Found a lot of other evidence to corroborate this. Years later, a ranger by the name of S.N. Hardy, he'd served as a volunteer in this particular company under Captain McNally. He confirmed these methods when he gave an interview to J. Frank Dobie, the famed Texas folklorist, back in the 1930s. He said, one night while we were camped on the Rio Grande, I was in charge of the guard. Sandoval was keeping watch, and along about midnight I heard him cursing a blue streak in both Mexican and English. And I went down to see what the trouble was. What Hardy went on to recount then was a gruesome scene that evidenced Sandoval's determination to rid the region of bandits, particularly those that had raided his own farm and ranchito. For Jesus, it was deeply personal. When I got near the river, Hardy remembered, I saw an empty skiff which had come over from the Mexican side. Also, I saw Sandoval on a horse riding against that taut rope that was hitched to the saddle horn of his horse. The other end of the rope was tied to the neck of the Mexican, whose feet then were lashed to a mesquite bush. After Sandoval got through pulling, he dismounted and showed me another Mexican whose throat had been cut to the neck bone. Before Hardy could inquire, old Jesus explained that these two were the last of the gang who had burned his home and ruined his wife and daughter. I did not say anything to Captain McNelly for months. And then the man remembered, lots of things happened on the Rio Grande that never got into the Ranger reports. Lots of things happened. Pardon me, maybe I'm having my Marco Rubio moment. At least I don't have a cup of water here. The Palo Alto Prairie. The Palo Alto Prairie. On the morning of June the 12th, 1875, and this is just weeks after McNelly's company arrived on the border. I don't know if you know where the Palo Alto Prairie is, but it's just upriver from Brownsville. And interestingly enough, it's the exact same area where the U.S.-Mexican War began 3 decades before this, the Battle of the Palo Alto, where a great war that would change the destiny of two North American nations began. June 12, 1875, a running gun battle equal in ferocity to that earlier campaign. After trailing the bandits, this is a different group of bandits, after trailing them through the pre-dawn hours, McNelly moved in and located them at a salt marsh soon after sunrise. By then, an early morning fog had lifted. On arriving, I found them drawn up in a line on the south side of the marsh about 600 miles wide, McNelly later reported. And the marsh was filled with mud and water, 18 to 20 inches deep. The raiders had driven their herd onto a small island surrounded by a boggy plain. The captain surveyed the scene through his field glasses and then formed a skirmish line. McNelly didn't want his men with repeating rifles because he said they really didn't have enough distance. They couldn't project far enough, so he had outfitted his company with Sharps carbine rifles that would reach accurately to over 300 meters, unlike a Winchester or a Henry rifle. The captain surveyed the scene. He figured if one of his men couldn't make a shot with the first shot, he didn't want him in his company anyway. So he didn't want this repeating rifle business. They weren't going to allow the others to get that close to them, hopefully. The captain surveyed the scene through his field glasses, then formed a skirmish line, not yet allowing his rangers to unsling their Sharps or to draw their pistols. As soon as McNelly's company closed in to within 500 meters, the bandits dismounted and opened fire with repeating rifles, and the rounds fell harmlessly in front of the rangers as they advanced at a slow gait to within 100 meters of their prey. As Durham recalled, the thieves were, quote, well forded for a standoff, as if they were expecting help from somewhere. Then just as the rangers moved to within pistol range, the rustlers leapt upon their horses, wheeled around, and galloped away in an attempt to escape, abandoning a herd of over 100 cattle, which they were driving trying to cross over the river into Mexico. In anticipation of the retreat, McNelly had already ordered three of his best riders and best shots to a timber line between the bandits and the Rio Grande, and there to flank them and, quote, force a stand. And what followed next was a series of skirmishes extending over 5 or 6 miles. When the bandits broke out in groups of two or three and scattered over the prairies, the rangers spurred their mounts in pursuit of them. Captain McNelly leading the way, urging his men to ride close and, quote, powder burn them. One by one, the rustlers were gunned down, several riders having their horses shot from under them. I've never seen men fight with such desperation, McNally later reported to the adjutant general, and thus to the governor of the state, Richard Coke. Many of them, after being shot and severely wounded three or four times, would rise upon their elbows in the mud and fire at my men as they passed. McNally overhauled one of the fleeing raiders, shooting his fleet mount several times, sending the horse tumbling into the mud and the injured rider scrambling through ankle-deep water toward the tall marsh grass known as Spanish Dagger. As the captain dismounted and approached the vaquero, the man suddenly emerged from the brush, grinning and wielding a dagger, according to McNally's report. Apparently, the bandit had emptied his pistol and believed McNally had done the same. That was a mistake. Calmly, while the knife-wielding rustler raced toward him, McNally raised his revolver and, at a distance of a few feet, according to Callicott, placed the last shot he had between the bandit's teeth as if he'd put it there with his fingers. 17-year-old Barry Smith, the youngest ranger in this company, 17 years old. He and his father were both serving with McNally that summer. He was neither as experienced nor as lucky as his captain. After one bandit fell from his horse and lay motionless in the mud for a few moments, seemingly dead, Sonny Smith slid from the saddle, holstered his pistol, and approached the lifeless body. But the wounded man turned over suddenly and shot Smith dead, and then crawled into a pond a few feet away, disappearing into thick marsh weeds. In the meantime, Captain McNally, according to eyewitness accounts, had shot and mortally wounded another rustler, then disarmed the dying man and recited the scriptures to him as the man drew his last breaths. I mean, that's proper and appropriate. He was a good and decent man. He'd shot the man, so he said some scriptures over him. Then when McNally arrived at the pond moments later and saw Sonny Smith's corpse and learned that his killer was hiding in the brush in the pond, McNally lost his piety. Seeing a slight movement in the murky water, he called several rangers around him. They surrounded the pond and opened fire on a suspicious-looking clump of rush grass. And when the shooting finally stopped, the man's thrashing body floated to the top of the water, bloodied and riddled with bullets. By noon, the Palo Alto fight was over. It took more than 2 hours. It was a running fight, with this group of rustlers doing most all the running. Carefully, the rangers tied Sonny Smith's body across his horse and led him back toward Brownsville, where they prepared to honor him with a funeral with full military honors. He's buried in a cemetery right there near old Fort Brown. Barry Smith is. He's only 17 years old. As for the 12 dead raiders who were gunned down that morning, they were treated with much less respect. The rangers roped their bodies, dragged them through the mud for more than a mile, then piled them into a wagon. And later that day, McNally and his men rode into Brownsville, into the town plaza, and in the words of George Durham, stacked those bodies like cord wood. Word spread of the ghoulish display of the dead, and so did anger and sorrows. McNally's sentries guarded the bodies through the night, and the next morning, not allowing any relatives to claim them or carry them away. It was a noche triste, a night of sorrows that Brownsville would never forget. By the way, the cattle rounded up at the Palo Alto Prairie. McNally later reported most all of them had the Running W brand on them. I don't know if you would recognize that. That's the King Ranch. His friend Richard King. most of the cattle rounded up there had the Running W brand of the King Ranch. Of course, King had a lot of cattle that didn't have that brand also. He was about as good as finding lost cattle as everybody else was in South Texas in those days. It was an art form, you know, to find lost cattle, meaning whatever you could round up. By the way, those raiders also, lest anyone thought they were innocent, McNally reported to the adjutant general that they had the same saddles, several of the same weapons, and other items that were taken from a store in New Aces Town just weeks earlier in a raid on a post called a raid on Tom Noakes' store at Nueces Town, over 150 miles north of there. McNelly wanted to make certain that the people of Brownsville, Cameron County, and all of the Lower Rio Grande Valley understood that Los Diablos Tejanos, the Texas Devils, had returned to the border. The next one, I'll just call this next one as the chapter's title, and this will be the last one, Crossing the Jordan. Crossing the Jordan. In this case, not the Jordan of the Sea of Galilee, but the Rio Grande. I found in one source where some of the rangers loved to sing at night. Some of these, and they were very young indeed. Here's a picture of two others that are unidentified. We don't know who they are, but we know they served in this company. That they loved to sing gospel hymns or something else, and one of them was an old gospel hymn that spoke of crossing the Jordan. So I've entitled this chapter appropriately, Crossing the Jordan. Now McNelly, after the Palo Alto fight, the fight at the Palo Alto Prairie that I just described part of that, he had to convalesce for some time. He was very ill, as you can imagine. And there are descriptions, and I don't really want to go into detail as to what happens to someone with tuberculosis, but it is a terrible disease. And his men said that though he tried to hide that from them because he didn't want to show any signs of weakness, that for 3 weeks he went to Brownsville to convalesce. And then he returned to the campsite. By the way, that's Juan Cortina, the so-called Red Robber of the Rio Grande. Juan Nepomuceno Cortina, who becomes the Rangers' chief nemesis for almost a quarter of a century. Old Rip Ford pursued him, tried to bring him into justice, befriended him. They had an interesting relationship. And now McNelly confronts this man's Rustlers. And this man, by the post-Civil War era, was basically overseeing the largest cattle rustling operation ever on the borders of Texas. Word was out that autumn that Cortina had ordered that 18,000 cattle be rounded up because he had an order for a shipment to Cuba for 18,000 head of beeves. And you can imagine how much cattle rustling is going to go on both sides of the border in order to fill such an order. And by the way, there was a port south of the river just across from Texas soil, appropriately called Baghdad. And in fact, my opening chapter is called The Thieves of Baghdad. But it's spelled differently from Baghdad, Iraq, B-A-G-D-A-D. But there were reports that ships in Baghdad were going to transport 18,000 cattle to Cuba. After convalescing, I'll pick up the narrative again, after convalescing for 3 weeks, the ailing Captain McNelly returned to the border in the first days of November, renewed and regenerated, his health revived, and I would say at least as much as it could be at the time. Soon after rejoining his company near Brownsville, he learned from his scouts that Cortina had contracted, as I said, to ship at least 18,000 head of beeves to the Cuban market by the beginning of the year. On November the 12th in Brownsville, he penned a note to Adjutant General Steele, clearly revealing his intentions. "I will move up the river tomorrow and think that I may be able to do some good." Major Alexander, he's referring to Major A.J. Alexander of the United States Army, says that he will instruct his men to follow raiders anywhere I will go. "I hope to be able to put them to the test in a few days. I should think myself in bad luck if I don't find some bandits on this side or the other side of the river soon." There you see his intentions. He's going to follow them even into Mexico, and even without authorization. That's what makes this little event, the Las Cuevas War, so interesting. 3 days later, Ranger spies reported that more than 100 cattle had been driven across the river into Mexico, no more than a mile below Ringgold Barracks. That's Rio Grande City today. Within the next 5 days, scouts informed McNelly that two additional herds of stolen cattle, numbering 500 or more, were rustled across the Rio Grande a few miles below Brownsville. Then on November the 19th, the captain decided he'd had enough patrols, enough reports, enough talk about border bandits holed up in their havens south of the Rio Grande. Now the time had come. McNelly determined himself to cross after them. This is the only known photograph of some of McNelly's men. He's sitting on a stool on the right over there, I think you can see. Whether or not McNelly had received secret permission from the United States Department of War to trail rustlers across the river into Mexico remains unclear. It's clear to me he did not have such authorization from either the governor of Texas or the adjutant general of the state of Texas. But one thing seems certain. Neither Colonel J.H. Potter, commanding the African American troops at Fort Brown, Buffalo soldiers at Fort Brown, neither Colonel Potter nor his superior, General E.O.C. Ord, nor Adjutant General William Steele in Austin tried to stop him. Catch that? No, none of them tried to stop him. They didn't give him authorization, but they didn't try to stop him. That's what modern day politicians call, and it's an art form now, the ability to what's plausible deniability. That's what politicians, the euphemism they apply to it today. You go ahead and do it with a wink and a nod. I can't claim any ownership over it, though. Walter Prescott Webb speculated in his classic narrative, The Texas Rangers, that there can be little doubt that the Ranger captain had some deep scheme in mind, and it seems that his purpose was to bring on war with Mexico. That was a bold statement for Webb to make. And decades later, a historian named Michael Webster likewise argued that McNelly engaged in intrigue and mischief in an attempt to provoke a confrontation with Mexican rurales or even federal forces in hopes of bringing on another conflict with Mexico. I have not come to that conclusion. I believe what he was trying to round up was a few hundred head of Texas cattle and bring them back to ranchers in South Texas, including Richard King, who, by the way, Richard King had provided horses and some firearms for the men of this company. The plain truth appears to be less spectacular than Webb had speculated. McNelly, a man motivated neither by political ambitions nor a sense of history, simply set out on November the 18th, 1875, to punish a small army of banditti and to recover several hundred head of Texas cattle. By the way, legend has it that when he told his men they might be actually going across the border that week into Mexico, he said, "Don't worry, I won't send you, I'll lead you." Relentlessly, McNelly's Rangers pursued a band of rustlers to the Rio Grande on the afternoon of November the 18th. They arrived too late, however, to prevent the escape of the rustlers and their cattle across the river. They literally saw the cattle on the other side of the river by the time they arrived. This was just below Ringgold Barracks, several miles, and near a rancho said to exist called Las Cuevas. After nightfall, the Rangers rested their heavily lathered horses, and they were all exhausted, men and horses alike, on this mission. The captain called his men together and explained that they were likely going into Mexico. A company of U.S. regulars was encamped nearby with two Gatling guns trained on the south bank of the river, he pointed out to them, but they were under orders by their commanders not to cross into Mexico under any circumstance whatsoever. Anyone willing to follow him across the river and assume the risk they might never return should therefore step aside, McNelly ordered. I can just see him now. He had a habit of chewing or twirling a cigar in his mouth. He didn't smoke it because he was suffering from, you know, his lungs were racked with tuberculosis, but he loved the taste of a cigar, according to sources. It started just before midnight when five Rangers swam their horses across to the Mexican side before McNelly realized that quicksand on the south bank made it too perilous there to ford. The remainder of the company therefore left their horses behind and paddled downstream in a small, leaky rowboat that they had found. Two men, three men at a time, and once on Mexican soil, they huddled quietly until morning. By the way, this was not the first time Texas state troops had crossed into Mexico in recent years, but it was the first time in over a decade. At first light, on the next morning of the 19th, a young Mexican guide led McNelly and his men into a bank of fog down a narrow cattle trail. Now we're on the Mexican side of the river. Through tall grass and thick underbrush, only the creak of leather could be heard as they followed their captain's hand signals until they came to a split rail fence no more than a half mile from the river. At that point, the tall, sandy-haired giant, the sergeant, John Barclay Armstrong, this was taken at a later date. John B. Armstrong is remembered in Ranger lore and history for being the guy who tracked down John Wesley Hardin into Florida. I don't know if some of you have heard that story. Just a couple of years after these events, they said that, you know, John Wesley Hardin, one of the worst killers that had ever been unleashed upon Texas, that he was asleep on a train in Pensacola, Florida, and was awakened by a tall Texas lawman, John B. Armstrong. And according to legend, Hardin exclaimed, "Texas, by God," and Armstrong hit him with his Colt revolver, hit him across the head, pistol whipped him, knocked him to the floor, and knocked him unconscious, put handcuffs on him, and brought him back to Texas. Anyway, McNelly and his men, a half mile from the river, south of the border, in other words, Armstrong, Sergeant Armstrong, rode ahead and then returned and motioned to McNelly that the slumbering rancho lay just ahead. Out of the morning mist, McNelly's Rangers charged, yelling and shooting like devils possessed as they roared through the camp. And in less than 5 minutes, several Mexicans lay dead around a woodpile, their bodies placed there, being brought in for a body count. While the smell of gunpowder still hung heavy in the morning air, the young Mexican guide admitted that he thought this was a mistake. And Captain McNelly pressed him, "What do you mean? This is not Las Cuevas. This is not the nest of the thieves you're after. This is not Las Cuevas. This is the Ranchito Las Cucharas." Furious and red-faced, McNelly realized he'd lost the element of surprise. He'd attacked the wrong settlement. By the time he and his men could hurry another half mile down the trail to picketed cabins and corrals known as Rancho Las Cuevas, an estimated 300 armed riders descended upon them. They'd been alerted by the gunfire up the trail, and they were assembling for a counterattack. William Callicott remembered, "It was all open ground between us and the ranch, and we were lined up at the edge of the woods in plain view of them Mexicans." Luckily for McNelly's men, most of whom were on foot because they'd left their horses behind on the other side of the river, the first enemy volley sailed harmlessly over their heads. McNelly assessed the situation and very calmly commanded his Rangers to fall back in an orderly retreat to suppress the enemy with enough fire to fall back through the fog, which I think is the only thing that saved them that morning, the fog that was still hanging low around the river. And they fell back all the way to the south banks of the Rio Bravo and then entrenched themselves there along the side of the river, at the river bank. McNelly ordered his men to make a stand behind natural earthworks there, natural earthworks of mud and brush. He figured right that the leader of the bandits, a Juan Flores Salinas, who basically was an operative of Juan Cortina, he believed that he would assume the fleeing Rangers would be trying to swim the river back to Texas and that they would charge the river banks. That's exactly what Flores did. More than 100 men, Flores led them on a charge against the Rangers, only to find the Rangers rising up right in front of them there at the river's banks and firing a fusillade or a volley right into the Mexican rurales. And to call them rurales might not be entirely accurate. McNelly reported them that they were Mexican rural troops, but they were also the troops of Juan Cortina, the bandit chieftain. More than 100 horsemen were repulsed by a murderous fire from McNally's ranks. Twice again, the Mexicans charged the Rangers' makeshift fortifications alongside the river, and both times they retreated in the face of the gunfire, leaving dozens of dead and dying scattered over the field. Among them, Juan Flores Salinas. The standoff continued through the day, the next night, and even the following morning, as McNally and his men were pinned down by gunfire in their front and the river, the rushing waters of the river at their back. McNally did send a courier across the river and reported that the enemy, he could see them in the timbers that were still bristling with rifle barrels. "I'm in temporary earth," as he called it, "I am in temporary earth and have refused to leave until the cattle are returned." He scribbled a message and had it telegraphed to the Adjutant General of the state of Texas. "The Mexicans in my front number maybe 400. What should I do?" News streaked to Brownsville, on to Austin, and then Washington, D.C., that a company of 30-some-odd Texans had been cut off and virtually surrounded on the south banks of the Rio Grande. Within hours, cables came back from the United States Consul at Matamoros. His name was Thomas Wilson. From Colonel Potter at Fort Brown, and the Secretary of War himself, William Belknap, all urging McNally to surrender, to turn himself over to Mexican authorities. He'd ask, "What should I do?" He fired back, and this telegraph it's no longer in the state archives, but we know it existed because other writers have documented this one. I just know it's not there. My friend who works in the archives said it. Somebody lifted it and stole it. McNally fired back his stubborn response, and it was vintage McNally. "I shall remain in Mexico with my Rangers until tomorrow morning or longer if necessary, and shall recross the Rio Grande at my discretion. Give my compliments to the Secretary of War of the United States and tell him to go to hell." Dug in along the riverbank, McNally's Rangers waited. I'll jump to the end here. Ultimately, nearly 2 days later, a flag of truce was held up. And McNally met with not only a Mexican officer, but an Anglo who was riding with him, a physician, by the way, who was on the other side of the border making a fortune off of cattle rustling. McNally was satisfied that they'd agreed to return, they said, all the stolen cattle they had in the possession there at Rancho Las Cuevas. According to Durham, one of the Mexican officials tried to pull his revolver, but before his pistol cleared leather, McNally kneed him in the midsection. You get the picture. Then pistol whipped the man to the ground as a squad of Rangers trained their guns on several others. Pulling the agent, meaning the Mexican agent, to his feet, the captain growled at his interpreter, "Tell this man to order his hands to deliver the cattle over in an hour or he dies. Tell him what I said." Callicott remembered what happened next. "If ever you saw cattle put across the river in a hurry, they did it in less than 5 minutes." McNally would soon be called to Austin to answer for insubordination, and he would even traveled to Washington, D.C. months later to testify before a congressional investigative committee. And by the way, that was long lost because he was misidentified by name as Captain McNally, but S.H. McNally, but L.H., Leander Harvey McNally, later testified before Congress. And he was a man of few words, a man of action. January 1877. Newspapers reported that McNally had resigned for health reasons, but that didn't tell the story. George Durham said it best. He was down to be fired. His kind of law enforcing wasn't good politics. So the captain retired and rode off into history. He returned to his cotton farm near Burton with his wife and two children. And 9 months later, he died of consumption at the age of 33. By the way, he's buried on private property, and his friend Richard King, Captain King of King Ranch fame, paid for this very impressive obelisk over McNelly's gravesite, complete with romantic poetry and all. And so we have Leander McNelly as one of these iconic figures in Texas history. Complex. If you could read all of what I'm producing, and I hope someday you will when the book's published, you can see that I've balanced it. I've balanced the heroism with some of the really horrific scenes of violence and I guess what we could call misdeeds and atrocities as well, committed by people on both sides of the border, of both races, of both nations, of both cultures. It was a very violent time and place. A time when death was as common as the dirt that covered the plains of South Texas. And even the corridos, or the ballads that they sing along the border today, tell of those times and of what the people of Mexican heritage on both sides of the border call Los Renches. That's their phonetic pronunciation, referring to the Rangers. Or, as they also have other phrases for the Texans, Los Sangrientos Tejanos, Bloody Texans, and Los Diablos Tejanos, Texas Devils.